गुड इवनिंग एंड नमस्कार टू ऑल माय सीनियर्स एंड फ्रेंड्स. आई वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर टुडेज इवेंट. एंड फॉर ड्यूरिंग दिस टुडेज इवेंट आई वी टुक द अपॉर्चुनिटी टू रिलीज द फर्स्ट पब्लिकेशन ऑफ दिस मैनेजिंग कमिटी आई एम एंड माई प्रेसिडेंशियल टर्म ऑन द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ इनकम टैक्स सेटलमेंट कमीशन A practical guide authored by two chartered accountants, namely Shri K.S. Yoganandji and Mr. Kochar, Ashish Kochar. And for this, I thank as a president of this year to both the authors and past president and taxation committee chairman Shri Amit Patel, co-chairman Deepak Shah. And all the members of the taxation committee and his team members, and Amit Bhai will elaborate more on this. So over to Amit Bhai, please.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. President, and I join Suhas in welcoming all of you. As he mentioned, we are about to release a publication brought out by the taxation committee of the BCS today. This is the first publication of our committee for the year and also of the BCA Society for the year. And we are therefore delighted that we have this occasion today. The book is about settlement commission. This topic is not very talked about in the taxation fraternity amongst chartered accountants and definitely not amongst the taxpayers of the country. And unfortunately, even though it is so important from the perspective of settling disputes, settling matters with the government once and for all, it has not got the attention that it deserves. And therefore, the Taxation Committee thought it fit to bring out a publication dedicated to this subject. And when we were thinking about whom to approach for authoring this book, because there are very few people who specialize in this particular practice area. We thought of Mr. K.S. Yoganand, who is a very senior chartered accountant from Chennai, because he has been practicing in this field for last several years and has got tremendous experience and knowledge about this particular matter. And therefore, we approached him and requested him to author this particular publication, and he immediately agreed. He also brought along with him on the way his young partner, Ashish Kochar, who is also from Chennai. So both the authors are from Chennai. And we have both of them who worked very hard, particularly in the last few months of lockdown, and brought us this publication. The publication is drafted in a very simple and easy to understand language, and also in a very simple to understand and follow format. It's in the form of question and answers, and therefore it becomes very easy to try and figure out what you're looking for and what is the answer of that. The book is completely self-sufficient if one is looking at whatever is to be known about the practice, law and practice of settlement commission, the various case laws, the various circulars, notifications, the forms involved, etc., all have been given in this publication. And therefore, I'm sure that whoever is interested in trying to make a beginning in the practice of settlement commission will find this book extremely useful. On behalf of the Taxation Committee, my sincere thanks to Mr. K.S. Yoganand and to Ashish Kochar. And incidentally, it would be only appropriate for me to make a disclosure here that both of them happen to be my partners. And so to that extent, I am an interested party. But then in the practice of settlement commission, it is all about settling the matter, and we are not concerned with whether there is any interest or not. And therefore, I would like to place on record our sincere thanks to both the authors for A, agreeing to bring out this publication, and B, working during the lockdown and coming out with the publication. This is the first publication of the BCS in the lockdown caused by the pandemic. I would request the BCS staff to show a glimpse of the publication, and thereafter we will declare it released. Yes, here is the book. This is the cover page, Income Tax Settlement Commission, a practical guide. And if we go to the contents page, yes, so you have the genesis, the history of the settlement commission, how it is structured, how the commission is structured, how do you make applications, how are the applications dealt with, what is the procedure for that, what are the powers of the commission, and everything else that is related to this particular way of coming clean before the Income Tax Department and achieving a final closure on the matter. The forms, the notification circulars are there by way of an annexure. And therefore, it is with great satisfaction that I dedicate this book on behalf of the Taxation Committee for the members of the BCA Society, for the friends of the BCA Society. And once again, thank both the authors, and would request Mr. K.S. Yoganand, if you or if Ashish would like to say a few words to our members on this occasion. You may need to unmute yourself.
Thank you, Amit Bhai. I consider it as a privilege and honor to got this opportunity from the great organization like BCAS to go for a publication on the Settlement Commission. And I thank Amit Patel for proposing our name and all the committee members to have accepted for the proposal. And I thank Ashish Kochar, who has helped me in presenting it in the form which is available now. If it is useful for a few of the readers, I think it will be meaningful for putting such an effort during the lockdown period. Thank you very much. Thank you, BCAS.
Ashish, would you like to say?
Thank you. Yeah. So it's a great honor, sir, to join BCAS, and the book is to be recognized and published by the BCAS. And I would like to thank Amit sir, president, and the taxation committee of BCAS, who has constantly supported us during the entire lockdown. And lastly, to my author and my guru, thank you so much, sir, for having the faith in me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, both of you. And I now hand over the proceeding back to the president for taking forward the lecture meeting by Himanshu. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, Amit Bhai. Thank you, both the authors. And I'm sure this book will get a very good response from BCAS members and the professionals. With this, now we move to the second part, or the most important part of this event, that is the lecture meeting by past president of BCAS, CA Himanshu Kishnadwala. May I take this opportunity to introduce the BCAS to all of you in a brief. It is a voluntary body of chartered accountants with 9,000 plus members all over and 40,000 plus social media followers. BCAS is approaching to its diamond jubilee, that is 75 years in next 3 years. Presently, we are 72. It is always known for its quality standards and governance practices. This year, our theme is to reach to large number of members with the help of technology and digital. Due to all the events being on virtual platform, we observed that our programs are attended by the participants from various states and cities of India, and also international participants. One of the focus areas is to handhold and support MSME, SMEs, and small and medium practitioners for their sustainable future. We are aware that today many SMPs are not in a position to plan audits, finalization of accounts under work from home or work from office situation, travel restrictions, and the clients not ready with the data. The overall work is in a slow mode affecting the economics of the small firms. Moreover, there is no visibility of when the situation would get normalized. The train services, as far as the Mumbai is concerned, the lifeline is the train services would start and the life will come back on the track. With this background, we felt that on the technical aspect of the audits for the year 2019-20, the technical aspects and the practical aspects would be shared on this topic by CA Himanshu Keshnadwala, and he will share his experiences in this matter. With this brief background, I welcome all of you again. I welcome Himanshu Bhai for this lecture meeting. And I would request Abhay, our Vice President, to introduce Himanshu Bhai.
Thank you, President. Respected authors of the just released publication, Mr. K.S. Yoganand and Ashish Kochar, past presidents who are virtually on the dais, my office bearers who are on the dais, and seniors and friends. It is an honor for me also to introduce Himanshu Keshnadwala. I will, though he doesn't require any introduction to an audience which is dealing in audits and accounts, I will just like to say that accounts and audit is synonymous with Himanshu Keshnadwala. That's the level at which he has taken his own stature of dealing with accounts and audit. Qualified by qualification is a FCA, rank holder at both inter and final CA, senior partner at CNK and Associates LLP, having more than 400 persons employed and a multi-locational firm. He looks after the audits and assurance practice of the firm, and particularly large audits, corporates which include Fortune 500 company, India's implementation, investigations, due diligence, assignments, and conversion of financial statements from IGAAP to IFRS or US GAAP. In other activities, he is co-author of various books on accountancy and financial management from FYJC to TYBCOM. And his involvement with Institute has been with all the major committees which deal with the accounting and auditing aspects. And also a member of the Shield Panel of ICA for ICA Awards for Excellence in Financial Reporting. At BCAS, he has been the past president of BCA Society in the year 2006-07. Up to last year, since last three years, he was the chairman of the Accounting and Auditing Committee. And he is one of the marathon writers of the From Published Accounts column in the BCA Journal for more than 25 years. And he has been delivering lectures at various forums across the country on all the professional bodies, organized by all the professional bodies. With this background, I will request Himanshu to take us through the topic today. Thank you.
Right. So thank you, Abhay. Thank you, Suhas. The other office bearers present on this virtual dais and all my colleagues and friends present across this virtual platform. Gives me a great pleasure to be talking to all of you once again on a topic which I think has become more of an annual feature now, because there are so many changes which happen in accounts and audit that you need to be abreast of what all is happening. And frankly, this talk also gives us an opportunity in our office to get everything together at one place, which is what is just done today. There is nothing new which is you must be aware of, but everything what you must have read in the newspapers or journals or spoken in some seminars or study circles or within your colleagues, everything has been brought together at one place for easy reference when you are conducting your audits in that sense. So I have a presentation which we will, I will just start sharing. So can we see the presentation?
Okay. Yes.
So we go with the presentation per se. Right, so all important amendments relevant for audits of financial year 1920 And for 1920, obviously big challenge with this lockdown, which was there in the last few months. Everyone thought by May or June things will be normal, but I think we are now, we don't know the year in which it will get normal, though we keep on telling the months which are there. So whether it is now August 21, September 21, December 20, 20 or 21, when things get normalized, no one knows. So we have to start doing audits and get accounts, financial statements prepared within whatever limitations we have in that sense. You must have also read very recently and observed very recently that the auditing profession has all got shaken up. And that is what is shown here, that the whole audit profession is really shaken up in that sense because of a lot of actions or a lot of things which are happening in the profession as such. Now, I'm sure with a lot of changes which are listed down in this presentation, if we are able to still do audits, taking all those things into account, that A will come back to its right place rather than moving around here and there in that sense. So we will start really with the amendments in the Companies Act, go to the changes in maybe the accounting standards, auditing, some developments at NFRA, some other verticals or fields where changes are there which can affect your accounting and auditing. So all of them we will try to cover, which finally affect your financial statements in that sense. So the first thing with what we start is with the Companies Act changes. And if you take away the finance bill, which is there, the changes in the Companies Act are much more than the Income Tax Act on an annual basis now. And in fact, the Companies Act and the GST Act are competing with each other as to who has the maximum number of changes. If you leave aside the finance bill changes, which really come in as such. So a lot of these changes affect my audit also, and therefore we need to look into some of these changes to my Companies Act 2013 or the rules which are there in that as such. So the, one of the first things is on this section 77, that when you have to register charges, and this is something which we need to look at when we are verifying the secured loans taken by companies. The time limit of creating the charges has been extended when you make an application to the ROC. So as an auditor or while preparing accounts, you'll have to make sure that these charges are registered. Otherwise, appropriate disclosures will have to come in as that whether the charges are registered or not registered. The next is on removal resignation of auditors. You must be also reading off late that in a lot of cases, auditors need to resign or tend to resign because of various reasons. Now, whenever auditor now resigns, you have to clearly give letter why you are resigning, and within 30 days you have to file that with the registrar of companies. Otherwise there is some penalty which is levied as such. This was unlike in earlier cases where we used to very simply say that I don't have time, so I would not like to continue and resign. There is something more also on resignation of auditors going down the presentation, so we'll see more of resignation at that point of time. If you go on further, you had section 164, which talks of disqualifications for appointment of a director. And this is required in reporting in your main audit report, where you have to say whether a person is qualified or disqualified from appointment of a director. So you'll have to get this cleared from the company secretary or from the other managing directors and all, whether any director is disqualified or not. Then somewhere last year, you had this change which came about register of significant beneficial owners in a company. Now you must be reading about a lot of developments in the regulations, whether where the government is trying to find out who is the final beneficial owner in a company, in a corporate chain of companies. Now to that extent, now the Companies Act has amended section 90 to say that a register needs to be now maintained of who are the final significant beneficial owners in the company. As an auditor, you need to look at this because finally when you disclose the shareholding below that share capital in schedule 3, you need to write whoever is holding more than 5% shares. Now, looking at this register can make you change some of those disclosures which are there about significant beneficial owners in a company as such. It can even help you to find out if there are some related party transactions or loans and other things which may need reporting to be done in the CARO report or in maybe even sometimes in the main audit report per se. Then you have got section 135, and this is one section where some of the changes have not been notified. So if you see on the left hand side, the changes are there, but they have not yet been notified. Now, why I have covered this is because when this gets notified, there will be only a two-line notification which will come saying that so-and-so amendment in the Companies Act has been now notified effective so-and-so date. That will not carry out what is the change which has become effective as such. So it is important to know what is this change which will come as and when notified, and it is better to sensitize the company and the directors that this is something which can come at any point of time as such. Now on CSR, it is everyone knows that you need to spend 2% of the average net profits. And as of now, if you do not spend, there is no penal action or anything. You are only to report whether you have spent or not spent. However, as and when this change in the section gets notified, and a company has failed to spend the CSR amount, the board report should write the reasons why you have not spent. And if the unspent amount does not relate to any particular project, then I have to transfer the unspent funds to a separate fund, which could be something like an investor protection fund or something. And if the unspent amount relates to any ongoing project, then it has to be transferred to a special account in any scheduled bank within 30 days of the expiry of the financial year. Now, this is something like that capital gains account, where if you want to buy a building or construct a house, for that temporary period, you need to park your funds in a special bank account. Now, this is some similar special bank account where you need to park your unspent CSR funds if the amounts are committed. If they are not committed, you transfer it to a fund which would be designated by the government. Could be IEPF similar fund, or could be even something like your Prime Minister's National Relief Fund or something as such. So we need to sensitize the companies and directors that if you do not spend money on CSR, so far it was good, but as and when this section gets notified, you will need to spend it urgently, or it will just go to the government as such. Series of notifications have also come during the year where they have added more activities that qualify as CSR. So you had something in May 19, which came for disaster management, in October 19, something for incubators and universities, which got added. And again, in November 19, there was some corrigendum to the earlier list, which was there as such. As and when this COVID really started developing, again, a series of notifications where they said what you spend for COVID-19 is eligible under CSR. Then on 28 March, you had this PM CARES Fund, which was Prime Minister's Citizen Assistance and Relief in Emergency Situation Fund, which also will qualify as CSR. The ministry suddenly came up with a set of FAQs on eligibility of CSR related to COVID-19 activities. Now, all this is relevant when the company has spent money on CSR for reporting for 1920 as such. And a lot of questions have been asked that whether if I give food to the poor people, to the migrants, will it qualify as CSR? And the answer there was no, such things don't qualify. But if I have given it to an association, which in turn has fed food to the poor people or to the migrants, then it can qualify as a CSR or something. So a lot of such things get clarified in these FAQs, which have been issued by the ministry as such. And a lot of other guidance really came in for CSR. You had this circular on FAQs, then the institute, not to be left behind, said that if organization needs a report on whether CSR activity is properly carried out, there would be an independent practitioner's report on utilization of funds, and the institute gave out a format of that certificate as to how do you certify utilization of CSR funds. Now, see the wording of the certificate. It says independent practitioner's report on utilization of such CSR funds. It could have been actually worded as independent chartered accountant certificate. I do not know why instead of chartered accountant, they prefer to use the word independent practitioner's report. It could also mean, therefore, that even if you are not a chartered accountant, you can issue such a certificate, because you could be practicing anything. You could be, for that sense, practicing music also. And you can still issue such a certificate as such. But anyway, it comes from the institute with these wordings which are there as such. Himanshu, in July.
Himanshu, can you, just to interrupt, sorry to interrupt, Himanshu.
Yeah, bhai.
I think some sound is coming from your instrument. Can you just check? Because
I'm in my cabin and it is closed and okay. I don't see any sound. Maybe I can put my phone a little away.
Okay.
Himanshu bhai, is it that you have some speakers in front of you? Because I believe there is this friction of noise that is coming and that's resulting in...
No, I don't have any speakers. It's straight my desktop, which the speaker which I am using.
Oh, okay. But maybe if there is some electronic device, maybe you can keep it at some distance.
Only my phone was there, which I have put it aside now. So okay. I hope that improves it or something.
Okay.
Better?
Yeah. No, the shrilling sound is still there.
But I'm not getting any sound.
Oh. Okay, doesn't matter. Sorry to bother.
Okay.
No, that's fine. That's fine. Right, so we were on this additional guidance which has come. Now the institute also came out with a technical guide on accounting of expenditure on CSR activities in July. And when that technical guide has come, they have withdrawn the guidance note on accounting for expenditure on CSR. Therefore, you have two things which you really need to look at, whether you are eligible, not eligible, how do you account for CSR. You have the FAQs of MCA which came on 10th April. And you have this technical guide from the institute on accounting of expenditure for CSR. Other than these two, nothing else will really be now relevant because everything else will be withdrawn or not be relevant when you are looking at CSR accounting or how do you audit such things in that sense. A issue which has come in accounting and obviously in auditing therefore is expenditure on CSR subsequent to the year end. Now, if you see the concessions given by the government somewhere in March, if deduction is allowed on expenditure on CSR, also under section 80G, and the amount is spent after the year end, because that's what the income tax concession says, that even if you spend after the year end, you will still be eligible for section 80G deduction. How do you treat it for deferred tax? Deferred tax normally talks about a temporary difference where the deduction is claimed in the accounts in 1 year, but the income tax gives you a deduction in a later year. Here it's the reverse. Income tax gives you a deduction first and you are accounting it later. How do you treat it for deferred tax? Now that's the issue which, especially if the amounts are material, you will have a problem because if you look at the relevant accounting standard, whether it is accounting standard 22 or Ind AS 12, there is no clear clarity on how do you treat such deferred tax where the deduction is first and the accounting is done in the next year or something. If it is not material, you need not bother about it. Otherwise, this is an issue which is being debated. And frankly, logically, if you see, you need to create something like a deferred tax liability for this, not a deferred tax asset, because I'm claiming the deduction first and then going to account for it in the next year. Then some other changes which came to the Companies Act. Again, this is a section not yet notified or a change not yet notified. Investigation into affairs of a company by SFIO. And SFIO is given much more powers now. And even any officer not below rank of an assistant director can arrest someone in the company. And SFIO, if it is given such a power, it really can be misused or used selectively or whatever which is there. Because SFIO has the power to investigate lot of cases and they are currently investigating lot of cases. And with this power to arrest, there is one more authority which can have the power to arrest. And it could be anyone, it could be a director, it could be an auditor also, which they can go and arrest in that sense as such. Not yet notified, but very soon likely to be notified. Then on the registration of charges, if the registration of charges are not filed, you can always file a modification in this particular form. Again, there is some concession on the dates which is given. Again, when you are looking at secured loans, you will need to look at this particular change in the rules which is there, which was effective from April 2019. On qualification of directors, again, when you are reporting whether a director is eligible, not eligible, qualified, not qualified, you'll have to see whether the directors have filed this e-form for active, which is there as such. If they have not filed this active form, then the director may not be really active in the system as such, and maybe an appropriate reporting to that will be there, because in the ROC website, you may find that name of a director as director of an active non-compliant company, because that is how they are going to mark it on the ROC or the MCA website against the name of that particular director. Then somewhere in October 2019, you had this whole change on independent directors, that whoever is an independent director or wants to get appointed as an independent director should register with this Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs. And once you register with the Institute of Corporate Affairs, you have to pass a particular exam which is there. However, if you are already independent director for more than 10 years, you don't need to pass that particular exam which is there. And once you pass the exam, you have to get registered with IICA. There are fees for some 25,000 rupees for lifetime registration here in the data bank. If you have not done this particular process, then you may not be able to continue as an independent director beyond the particular date which is there. And I know for a fact that in the lockdown, we had a lot of chartered accountants who cleared this particular exam. The exam is free of cost. Once you then apply, there is a charge to be done. But a lot of chartered accountants in this lockdown appeared and cleared this particular exam of being appointed an independent director. I do not know how many of them have already got appointed as independent directors, but I believe they only cleared the exam and they are waiting for some company to invite them to become an independent director as such. Then on startups, there were some changes which came again in the middle of last year. And this is relevant when you are doing this accounting for ESOPs or when you are looking at some concessions or compliances of the Companies Act. So ESOPs can be issued for up to 10 years from incorporation, and who can be issued, that is described here, what could be employees and what would really qualify as a startup as such. Up to 10 years from incorporation, turnover not more than 100 crores and working towards innovation and other things. So startups, there were some, and if you are doing the audit of a startup, all these provisions can become relevant because startups also get some other concessions, maybe in disclosures, reporting, maybe even in taxation, they get some disclosures which are there as such. Then on creation of debenture redemption reserve, again, some concessions which came last year. The main concession was that DRR is not required in case of public or private issue of debentures for both listed and unlisted companies. Now, before this change came, even for a public and private issue of debentures, DRR was required. But now this is not required only for this specific category, which are issued by even listed or unlisted companies. And if you already had a debenture redemption reserve or where you are otherwise eligible to create, then you have that 15% of the debentures maturing in the next year should be deposited in a specific bank account with a scheduled bank free from any charge or lien or in unencumbered securities or central or state government. And the money has to be used only for redemption of debentures and no other purpose as such. And in case your debentures are partly convertible, the DRR is only for the non-convertible portion which you really need to create. Then on the investor protection fund, there were again some changes that you need to keep a record for all things, all transfers done under this rule in the same format along with all supporting documents. An authority can come and inspect your records. So this is again one more inspection which a company can expect, that the IEPF can come and inspect your records. And it's also clarified that all shares in respect of which dividend has been transferred even before 2016 will need to be transferred by the company in the name of the IEPF. So not only dividend which you have transferred in the past, even the shares for that would need to be transferred. Now, from 16 to 20, there could have been other transfers which have happened in those shares, though the dividend has gone to IEPF. Now the company will have to literally take back those shares from the respective shareholders and transfer it in the name of the IEPF as such. And this clearly applies even to private limited companies. Then on merger and amalgamations, a circular had come somewhere in again August 2019. There was always a debate as to what is an appointed date. And the amendment or the circular said that subsection 6 of the 232 said that scheme will be deemed to be effective from the appointed date and not a date subsequent to the appointed date. Now the circular clarified, or the MCA clarified, that the provisions enables the company to choose and state in the scheme any appointed date. The date could be a specific calendar date or could be even tied to the occurrence of an event such as grant of a license by a competent authority or some conditions agreed upon by parties or meeting any other requirement which are relevant to the scheme as such. Now, this actually helps a lot of schemes to have a proper accounting, because a lot of schemes say that, say, for instance, two telecom companies are amalgamating. The scheme will clearly say that the amalgamation will be effective not only from the date when the High Court approves the scheme, but it will be effective from the date maybe the telecom department authorizes my scheme. Now, that date is uncertain. And it was always a question, therefore, as to what would become my appointed date. Now, with this clarification of MCA, it is very clear that if the scheme says that the appointed date is dependent on the happening of some future event, then your appointed date can be shifted to that particular date which is there as such. And the entire accounting of amalgamation or merger really starts from the appointed date. It's not effective date is when the approval comes, but your accounting really starts from what is called the appointed date, which is there as such. And this appointed date can have serious consequences, especially when you are accounting for mergers or amalgamation under the Ind AS perspective, where under Ind AS 103, business combinations could be a very strict standard sometimes to fulfill as such. Then you had this section 132. Constitution of NFRA, which really got effective from 15th August 2019. 15th August is otherwise an Independence Day for the whole country, but on this day last year, all the auditors, I believe, lost their independence because now they got covered under NFRA per se. So you have NFRA, which can now perform its functions through such divisions as may be prescribed by central government. You have a chairperson, a full-time member. There's an executive body of NFRA, and if professional or other misconduct is proved, NFRA has the power to debar members from being appointed even as auditor or internal auditor for a period of 6 months to 10 years. We'll see later on in how NFRA has used this power to debar some of the members of the institute who have been practicing since maybe long time also. The rules for NFRA also cover a lot of banking companies, and they have added those explanations for banking companies, and they have also added a rule 5. It says that every auditor of company governed by NFRA is required to file a return with NFRA on or before 30th November, which was earlier 30th April. And NFRA has also issued clarifications by issuing some FAQs on how do you file this form NFRA 2, which is there as such. And this is an annual return. So every year, auditors who are doing audit of any company covered under NFRA has to file this form. If you don't file this form, the auditor itself can be held guilty of not satisfying some conditions of this NFRA sections, which are there in the Act as such. And besides all listed company auditors who are covered, if you are doing audit of a bank, if you are doing audit of an insurance company, a state corporation, even if not listed, you will still be covered under NFRA rules. Even if you are auditor of a subsidiary company, which is not listed per se, but it's a subsidiary of a listed company, you may still be covered by the NFRA rules. So please be sure, if you are covered by NFRA rules, you need to fill up all these forms with the NFRA and file them online, which are there as such. Now, NFRA is a difficult thing to face, and that is what this portrays, that if you are going to face some action by NFRA, you will have to be properly prepared for it. All right. And though they don't give you any physical torture, there is a lot of mental torture, but you see this, how prepared you need to be for a regulatory audit, especially from NFRA as such. Okay, when it comes to related party transactions, some relaxations in November 19, which the rules amendment give. Now, earlier, for transaction entered into with a related party, the relaxation was that if it is 10% of or more of turnover or 100 crores, whichever is lower, I don't need approval. It can be really covered under that omnibus approval or something. they have now relaxed it to say, why have an upper limit? We let us just have 10% or more of the turnover. So for sale purchase, that upper limit of 100 crores has gone. Even for buying, selling property, that limit of 100 crores has gone. If you are leasing property, again, only that 10% remains, 100 crores gone. For availing of rendering services, that 50 crores limit has gone. It now just 10% or more of the turnover. So if you see everywhere, if you are crossing 10% or more of the turnover, then you may need some specific approvals. Otherwise, that omnibus approval will be sufficient for this related party approval by the audit committee or by the board, which is there as such. Then somewhere in 19 March, you had all these relaxations or all these new modes of conducting meetings which were announced. So on 19 March, you had that the following matters can be done through video conferencing or even any other audiovisual means. So that could be approval of annual financial statements, board's report, prospectus, audit committee meetings, approval of matters for amalgamation, merger, etc. Now, this was all up to only 30th June 2020. Now, I believe this has finally got extended to 30th September also, but could not get hold of that particular rule or change which was there. What I found finally was only up to June 20, but I'm sure even if not extended, it will finally get extended even up to September or maybe even up to December 2020 in that sense. Now, this was important because earlier without this rule, if that was approval of financial statements or any important meeting of say amalgamation or something, physical presence was necessary. With this rule now coming in, physical presence is not necessary and you can do that even now on video conferencing or any audio visual means. The rules also say that if you are doing any meeting like this by video conferencing or audio visual means, you need to record the meeting and store that recording for a particular period, could be 3 years, 5 years, which is there in the rules as such. Now that's a challenge because when you do keep a recording of the meeting, lot of discussions which are in the meeting also may get recorded. So sometimes it's a challenge to make sure that the meeting happens without any loose talk or something, because the whole meetings now really get recorded on that video conferencing or audio visual means which are there as such. You had this rule which came last year in October on active company tagging identities and verification. So this is again where the government or the MCA wanted to make sure that the company is a genuine company, and you have to file this form for active companies who had not enough directors or some DINs were inactivated or something. So if your audit falls in some such category, make sure whether the company has filed these forms, DIR-12, to make sure that your company remains an active company. Otherwise, appropriate remarks need to be included in your audit report as such. Then the rule or the change in the rules is also about this NBFCs, that all NBFCs who comply with Ind AS should also file financial statements with registrar together with AOC-4, Ind AS and consolidated FS along with AOC-4, CFS, NBFC, Ind AS. These are some new forms which need to be filed by by NBFCs who are going to comply with Ind AS, which is there as such. And by March 20, a lot of NBFCs have started to follow Ind AS because once they cross that threshold, or if you are a subsidiary of a bigger NBFC, then automatically you also need to follow the Ind AS rules which are there. Then matters to be included in the board report. In October 19, a change came that a board report or a director's report should have a statement regarding the integrity, expertise and experience of an independent director. Now, this is almost a mandatory thing. So wherever you have an independent director, make sure that this paragraph is there, that the independent director has integrity, he has expertise and experience, including proficiency, which is there as such. And proficiency means whether you pass the test, which was there by IICA, which we referred to earlier. If you pass the test, you are proficient. If you are not able to pass the test, you are not proficient in that sense. On appointment of company secretaries, there were again some changes which came. So if you have a audit of a company where these thresholds are satisfied, you will have to make sure that the company secretary is appointed as per these thresholds which are there as such. So earlier it was only with 50 crores capital or turnover of 250 crores. Now they are even covering the loan criteria which is there. And of course, that is applicable for all financial years commencing on or after 1st April 2020. But better to tell the company to be aware about these changes also, which are there as such. Then this was a big change which came on 25th February, that the new CARO 2020 was introduced, and this was for reporting for 1920. It was then relaxed to 2021. And so two notifications came on February. They announced CARO 2020, and on 24th March, just within a month, they said, now we are postponing this by 1 year, obviously because of this COVID-19 situation which is there. Now at the BCA RRC, we had a detailed discussion on this CARO 2020, because that happened somewhere in the first week of March 2020, where the postponement was not known as such. And there is so much extra reporting on frauds, loan defaults, whistleblower complaints, evergreening of roles, Benami properties, and so on. So what we discussed at that time also, that there is so much future, there's so much in the future which you now need to look at, that really the auditors will have to start using some new tools for doing audit from next year onwards. So you will have to keep some such tools with you to decide whether the company will be running in the nature, whether there is any evergreening of loans, because without these tools, you will not be really able to project what is the company likely to do in the future as such. On the winding up, some rules have been relaxed for winding up, and a lot of companies are now saying that instead of running a company with so many compliances, let me take the winding up route. And though there is a relaxation which is given here effective 1st April 20, auditors will still have to as to what they are doing when they conduct the audit as such. If a company decides to file applications under these new rules of winding up, the financial statements of the company will have to be prepared on a winding up basis or on a liquidation basis. Then you cannot prepare your financial statements on a going concern basis. And that is exactly why these rules are, or this slide is taken up here, that in case a company has filed any application under these rules, your financial statements will be prepared under liquidation basis and not under going concern basis. And that will change a lot of reporting requirements as such, because your inventory, your fixed assets, everything then is accounted for on a realizable value rather than even at cost or market, whichever is lower or something. You also had this scheme which was introduced, that if you have a company which has a lot of defaults in filing your earlier annual returns and other things, you had a company's fresh start scheme of 2020, and the scheme came into force on 1st April 20 and will remain in force till the end of this particular month. Again, most likely to get extended maybe till December or something. And what the scheme says that if you are a dormant company and not filed any forms in several years, pay some certain fees which are there and your company can get reactivated. Now, as auditors, if a company like this gets reactivated, you have a challenge, because you may have to give audit reports for maybe 4 or 5 years at the same time. So at what date will you give the reports? How do you get all the information of the past years and all? It's a challenge. But this definitely helps companies to become active, especially if they are dormant, only because they have not filed certain documents with the ROC and such other things which are there. Then as part of the relaxations, the MCA also came out with this LLP settlement scheme of 2020. Now again, this is applicable from 1st April and in force till 30th September. And in addition to companies, especially private companies, we have a lot of LLPs which did not file their returns or documents with the registrar of companies. LLP is generally an organization where we do not pay as much attention as a private limited company, and therefore a lot of filings have been missed out by LLPs as such. And this scheme therefore is good for all LLPs, and if you have any clients as LLPs, it is good to advise them that please take benefit of this, file all the old documents which are there and use this settlement scheme to reactivate. Again, when you are doing audit of a LLP, the provisions of reporting do apply, though of course there is no audit report format as such, but the normal accounting and the standards on auditing do apply even when you are auditing a LLP as such. Then lot of special measures announced by the Companies Act and the LLP Act in view of COVID outbreak. So the measures, you must be reading this from time to time, all brought together at one place. No fees for late filings for a moratorium period of for April to September. The mandatory period for holding meetings within the prescribed interval has been extended by 60 days for the two quarters, June and September. CARO postponed by one more year. If independent director is not able to hold a meeting, then it is not to be viewed as a violation. Then the requirement of Section 73, which is creating that deposit repayment reserve, has been now extended till 30 years, was extended till 30th June. Again, that 15% of debentures in a specified mode of investment extended to 30th September. And a lot of these dates, frankly, can get further extended to September or even December in that sense as such. Newly incorporated companies are allowed a further period of 180 days to file that commencement of business declaration. For the minimum residency in India, that 1 year relaxation is given for any director to be in India for at least 182 days. So that 1 year relaxation has been given. And listed companies with more than 1,000 shareholders have been now allowed to hold these EGMs through video conferencing or any other audio visual. We had the EGM of Reliance Industries conducted, the first big EGM conducted on an online platform where I believe more than or maybe lakhs of members attended through the world which was there. They had two categories, one for shareholders, one for others, and a lot of people could attend through that audiovisual means which is there as such. So this was all regarding the Companies Act changes which have come in, some relaxations, some new benefits which were given, some changes which are all really relevant for conducting audits of 1920 as such. Now I can see a lot of questions in the or Q&A. Now, do we go to answer those questions now or do we take them all at the end till, or we move on to the next section first?
You can take it in the end together.
Okay, fine. Okay, so let's move on to this ICAI announcements and notifications which have been given in the last 1 year. So somewhere in September 2019, the Institute gave an advisory on reporting under 197.16. Now section 197 is on managerial remuneration. And that section said that you need to report whether the auditor shall in his report make a statement as to whether remuneration paid is in accordance with the provision of that section or whether it is in excess and give all the other details as may be prescribed. Now, this was a very strange change in the Companies Act because in CARO, we are anyway reporting about managerial remuneration. Now, in addition to that, 197.16 also wanted this reporting to be done. And the Institute came out with this advisory that please report in this particular requirement under that report on other legal and regulatory requirements. So all public companies, this doesn't apply to private companies because 197 doesn't cover private companies in that sense, but all public companies will have to give this additional reporting on 197.16. And frankly, the Institute was late in giving this advisory because this reporting applied for March 19 accounts also. But the Institute immediately therefore said, we are coming up with the advisory and it came into force into immediate effect in that sense. Then the Institute in June 19 clarified on the return of deposits pursuant to Rule 16. Now, if you recollect last year, the government had said that whenever you have got any deposits, please file some returns saying that whether they are covered into deposits covered under Section 73 or they are exempt deposits. And the auditors had to certify those returns which were there. The Institute in June 19 said that the auditor certificate is mandatory only in case of return of deposits. Wherever there is a transaction not considered as deposit, it need not be from duly audited statements. Only in case of return of deposit, information should be from audited statements which are there as such. And that clarification gave a format of how you have to issue that particular certificate. So in case the company has still not issued that certificate, or in a company auditor has not yet issued such a certificate, you can take benefit of or use this particular format which is given as such. Then use of electronic signatures. Now, once this lockdown came, everyone was wondering, how do I sign my audit reports? How do I sign certificates? And in April 20, the institute came out with this announcement, and this was really mainly for audit reports because it talks about only SA700 in that sense. So the AASB, the Assurance and Auditing and Assurance Standards Board, in April 20, looked at SA700 revised, also looks at the Information Technology Act, and said that the members of ICAI can use electronic signatures for signing reports. All reports issued pursuant to any attestation, engagement, and other certificates also. However, even when you are issuing reports with electronic signatures, the UDIN is mandatory and to be given. So, and lot of reports, if you now see post this particular date, have been issued using my digital signatures or electronic signatures, as they are called. A problem sometimes which we may face is, what happens to documents which are signed using my electronic signatures before this particular date? Because obviously the announcement doesn't clarify or say when this comes into force. So there would be some reports which have been signed even before this date, or certificate signed before this date using some digital means which are there. But anyway, that's something which will need some clarification going down the line. If someone starts questioning those particular certificates or reports issued before 13th April with electronic signatures. Then on the peer review, two announcements, one on 30th March and one on 29th May. And peer review is a very important process because if you don't have a valid peer review certificate, you cannot be reappointed for listed companies. You may not be eligible in CAG appointments. You may not be eligible for bank appointments or several appointments where empanelment is necessary. Now, because of the lockdown, a lot of peer reviews which were to be conducted really get stalled or something. So they have therefore issued an announcement in three categories, saying that in case the peer review process is completed but your certificate has not come, then you can have an extended validity of one more year from the earlier report, whichever is there. In case the peer review process was initiated and is ongoing, the validity again was extended by 1 year or something, provided of course that peer review has to be done within the process, within that period. And in case peer review has not been initiated, it has been state extended up to March 2021. So if your peer review validity was completing up to this 30th September, it is automatically now extended up to March 21. And in those cases, you have to really get your peer review completed before March 21. I'm sure these dates are further going to get extended because we don't see the peer review process really coming back to the normal manner till at least December 20, which is there as such. So peer review certificates which are currently there will remain in force for a much longer time, because this process will take time to again do it, and the institute will have to keep on extending these dates till you can really do a proper job on the peer review process. Then you have this important announcement on communication with the retiring auditor. Now, in May 20, the institute said that you need to communicate with the retiring auditor. And though it was said that you normally need an acknowledgement on a physical letter which is there, now it is said that you can communicate with the retiring auditor on email, provided an acknowledgement is received from the retiring auditor's email address, which is registered by the institute, or his last known official email address. And such acknowledgement would be deemed as valid evidence of positive delivery of communication. Again, a relaxation, but frankly, I do not know whether there was a need to write that it comes from a registered email ID or something, because how will the new auditor know what is the registered email ID of the earlier auditor which is there as such? But anyway, that's a relaxation that even on email, you can get your NOCs when you communicate with the retiring auditor. Then a lot of advisories issued by the Accounting Standards Board and AASB for impact of COVID-19 on financial reporting and auditing. They started on 27 March 2020, impact of novel coronavirus on audit of financial statements for March 31, 2020. Then as and when the lockdown extended, I think one by one, everything started getting issued. On April 20, COVID-19 FAQs on Ind AS were issued by the ASB, and that's a good set of FAQs because it deals with how accounting can be done, what are the things which you need to look at more closely because of COVID situation when you are dealing with Ind AS accounting as such. And it very closely examines things like expected credit loss provisioning, impairment testing, and so on. On 6th May, there was an advisory issued for statutory bank branch auditors as to how they approach this whole audit process in the lockdown situation. On 10th May, what are the going concern considerations for auditors amid COVID-19? On 13th May, physical inventory verification, key considerations. Now that physical verification, frankly, was a very late advisory which was issued because that could have been issued much earlier because people were still grappling as to what do you do in the absence of a physical verification which could not be done. 17th May, auditors reporting key audit considerations amid COVID-19, and on 23rd May, subsequent events on the key audit considerations which are there as such. Now, these are not the only items which affect auditor reporting. There would be a lot of other items which are there, and we will see that list slowly going down the presentation as such. And all these advisories were finally consolidated at one place by the institute, and that were issued somewhere in the month of June or July, all brought together at one place. But the same thing were just consolidated, no change in the words or anything in that sense. Some other changes which were announced by the institute, you had a conceptual framework for financial reporting under Ind AS. The exposure draft was issued in February 20, and the final conceptual framework issued just in before 10 days or something in the last week of August 2020. Now, this is something which was a very delayed thing which came in because you have a conceptual framework for our normal accounting standards. Though Ind AS is being applied by companies since 2015, so more than 5 years now, there was no conceptual framework. So frankly, it was something like having all the whole building without a foundation as such. So the whole building has come up before 5 years, but the foundation has come up now because the conceptual framework is now issued only in August 2020. Of course, you had the conceptual framework of IFRS, which we were using till the Indian framework came in. But it was a very strange situation that you had a whole set of 30-40 standards without any base to it or without any conceptual framework to it, which now finally now has been set right properly. Somewhere in May 19, the institute came out with FAQs on banning of unregulated deposit scheme ordinance 2019, which finally became an act also. These FAQs are important from an audit perspective also because lot of entities who have been accepting deposits can get covered under this ordinance or the act, and we will see some provisions of this later on in the presentation. In June 19, institute came out with FAQs on Companies Act 2013. Now, frankly, this FAQs of Companies Act are interpreting or describing various sections of the Companies Act. And sometimes you can get into a difficulty as to what really you finally follow. Do you follow the MCN clarifications? Do you follow these FAQs? Or, but in any case, you will have to now look at these FAQs on Companies Act, especially if you find a conflict with anything else which you have been doing so far as such. On Schedule 3, which is the format of my financial statements, guidance notes issued, two revised guidance notes, and one new guidance note which was issued. Now, as you, if you recollect, Schedule 3 has three divisions. Division 1 is for non-Ind AS companies. So for all private limited companies and all, we follow the Division 1. That guidance note was revised in July 19. Division 2 is for Ind AS companies. That was also revised in July 19. And Division 3 is for NBFCs. Because NBFCs started applying Ind AS only since last year. So March 19 onwards or something. And that guidance note was issued. The first guidance note on that was issued in October 2019. Besides that, Karo 2020, a guidance note was issued. I don't think any member has really opened and read this guidance note, because I'm sure they will read this somewhere only in March 21, when Karo 2020 really starts, you start thinking about this, or maybe when BCA starts holding programs on Karo 2020. It also issued MCQs on guidance note of Karo. Now, this is again a very strange thing. You have a guidance note, and within 3 days, you come up with what is called MCQs on the guidance note. So I don't know, what do you read first? Do you first read the MCQs, or do you first read the guidance note? Most members are still believing that the Karo 2020 may still get extended by one more year and may go right up to March 23 also. Because if the lockdown continues like this, then everyone is in March 21 going to say that please extend Karo 2020 by one more year. So no one is going to read the guidance note till that clarity really comes about. Now, we look at some retirement of auditors, and what this really sums up why auditors retire. Now, sometimes auditors retire when they look at your files and the company's record, then this is too much, I cannot certify this, so I retire or I resign. Or sometimes they don't look at anything, but they are so afraid that they really go back and resign as such. So the institute came out with a guidance on auditor resignation. Now, though this was issued in December 18, very relevant now also, and therefore I've repeated this from the last year's presentation also. And when you are withdrawing from an audit or resigning from an audit, it depends on the stage of completion of the audit. And if you have substantially done the audit, it is better not to resign, but only to disclaim an opinion and explain the scope of limitation. And you should describe the circumstances while giving reasons for resignation. Instead of just mentioning ambiguous reasons like preoccupation or personal reasons or administrative reasons or health reasons or mutual consent or something. You cannot have a resignation by mutual consent, because obviously it means that there is something wrong and you are both deciding that I will not report something wrong which a company has. So all these reasons which we were used to seeing before till last year or something are not acceptable now when you give an auditor resignation. In fact, some ROCs have issued notices to the auditors that you have given a reason that I was preoccupied or I have personal reasons. They said, if you had some preoccupation, why did you even accept the audit? And the auditor actually has to face penal consequences only for resigning in such cases as such. So this guidance goes on and says that if you really want to resign, there are some valid reasons for it. And non-payment of fees, inability to obtain sufficient appropriate evidence, possible effect of on the financial statement of undetected misstatements. If it is material misstatement, then you may even need to maybe issue some report before you resign, or if you cannot legally continue to be an auditor as such, and you seek legal advice if required. Now, this is a guidance given by the institute to its members. If you are an auditor of a listed company, there are rules which SEBI has also given as to when you can resign as an auditor. And the SEBI rules are fairly strict, because they talk about that if you are in the last quarter of a year, you cannot resign till you have given a report. So they are making sure that you don't resign for some flimsy reasons which are there. So if you are auditor of a listed company and you want to resign, in addition to these guidelines, you will also have to satisfy the SEBI guidelines on resignation of auditors, which have really come in, and they are quite stringent as such. So if you now look at some reasons which auditors are giving in the last maybe 2-3 months when they resign, even in listed companies, one common reason which has now come is the company cannot afford our fees. So they are saying our fees are high, our costs are high, and the company cannot afford our fees, so we are resigning. Which is a reason which has come up in the last 1 or 2 months in several big companies where, say, big auditors have resigned as such. What you also have is this new code of ethics, which came in from July 20. And this new code of ethics is a very far-reaching code which is there. It has really got this four parts which are there. Part one is for all professional accountants. Part two is for people in service. What we are really concerned as practitioners are this part three and part four which are there. And the institute has is going to obviously hold a lot of programs on this code of ethics, because this code of ethics are very stringent and far more strict as compared to the earlier code of ethics which were there as such. And the institute frankly did not have the time to really do a lot of dissemination of knowledge on the code of ethics, maybe because of the lockdown or whatever other reason, but it became effective from 1st July 2020 in that sense. So if you see, this code of ethics became applicable. However, the institute only said that only postponing these three things which are there: responding to non-compliance of laws and regulation, NOCLARE as it is called, then fees relative size, these two paras which are there, and taxation services to audit clients. Only these three things they said that we are deferring till further notification which is there. The last thing which is listed there, taxation services to audit clients, will have very far-reaching effects as and when the code is implemented. Now, irrespective of whether the code is implemented or not, NFRA has gone ahead and issued their own interpretation of taxation services to audit clients, which we will see later on. And on ethics, what we believe is that, and this is a good saying which I could find out, ethics is knowing the difference between what you have a right to do and what is right to do. If you follow this, I would decide what is right to do rather than saying what you have a right to do. And then it really brings out that you are really following the code of ethics which are there as such. Okay, so this was all regarding the institute's announcements, notifications, clarifications which they issued for in the last year, which are relevant really for our audits for 1920 which are there. Several other points which can affect your financial reporting. Now, a lot of people feel that when I'm doing an audit, I am only going to look at accounting standards and my business. And unfortunately, audits have no boundaries of verification. You are supposed to verify a lot of things. So you cannot have a boundary like this in an audit which is there as such, in an external audit especially. So in other words, we say that there is no scope limitation when it comes to a statutory audit as such. And this brings that out, that you really cannot have any boundaries. And because you cannot have any boundaries, as auditors, we have to look at a lot of other things which are just listed here in the next few slides which are there. The first is this Banning of Unregulated Deposit Schemes Act 2019. As we said, Institute has already given a FAQ on this thing when it was in the ordinance form. So it received the assent of the president on 31st July 19, and they became applicable with a retrospective effect from 21st February 19, the ordinance date which is there. And this act says that if you have taken a deposit from people who are not allowed to take a deposit as per this act, then there would be penal consequences on this. So if you're doing an audit of a company which has any deposits which are taken like this, then please make sure that you are satisfying the act or whatever are the penal provisions are there. Has the company complied with that, or any filings which are necessary, any permissions which are necessary, has the company dealt with this or not? The FAQ of the institute is fairly straightforward on this. So please have a look at the FAQ, especially when you believe that your client can get covered under this particular deposit banning of unregulated deposit scheme act itself. Then disclosure relating to MSMEs. Now, this is a disclosure as per Schedule 3, and companies have to file a half-yearly return for MSMEs. As auditors, we need to look at this half-yearly return for MSMEs, because that lists down what are the MSMEs, whether any delay is there in the payment of MSMEs and so on. As part of my ICFR, I need to look at what is the process followed by the company to identify such parties. And if there are delays, whether any interest provision is necessary for such delayed payments. What happens if there is a delay due to a COVID-19 situation? The MSME Act has not given any concessions so far. If no concessions are there so far, does interest provision become automatic? Again, something which may need to be discussed and decided with the client. In case you provide interest, the interest will be disallowed for tax provision. And companies and auditors follow different practices. Since no interest is claimed, no provision necessary. The company says the vendor has not claimed any interest, so I'm not making a provision. Some companies say that I'm providing for the interest, but I'm not informing the vendor because he has not demanded anything. So you provide the interest, don't pay the interest. What happens to this interest? I just disallow in income tax. After 2 or 3 years, you will just write it back. Or what happens after 2-3 years again needs to be seen as such. In any case, you need to make sure that the disclosures as per schedule 3 are properly given. You verify that half yearly return. And you also write how is the company identifying the information given for MSMEs as such. Because as auditors, you should not get caught by any wrong disclosure about MSMEs in the financial statements of a company as such. On employee-related remuneration, there are some developments which you need to keep in mind. You had this Supreme Court decision of Provident Fund in February 19. That Provident Fund is to be deducted on all elements of your salary. It was with a retrospective effect since clarificatory. All companies needed to implement this. And companies did an implementation in 3 different ways. Some people did it retrospective, very, very rare, but maybe some multinational company said we will implement this with retrospective effect. Some companies said I will implement it from February 19 or say from April 19, which is the first day of the year. So for April 19, they said we'll implement this decision of the Supreme Court. Some people said I don't want to give any effect because no notice has come to me. So I don't want to give any effect as such. Now, as an auditor, you need to take a stand from the company as to what is the company stand on the implementing of this decision. You cannot say that because I have not got any notice, I will not do anything. So you first find out in case they want to implement this decision, what is the impact on the extra provision which needs to be done. If that is a material amount, then as an auditor, you will need to take some representations or maybe in some extreme cases, even say a disclaimer saying that the company has not made a provision of this amount and the amount is not quantified or something. So some disclosure will be necessary if the amounts become very material. And for that, you will have to first ask the company to quantify the impact of this Supreme Court decision, which is there. A lot of people say that the Supreme Court decision is being reconsidered, but be rest assured the reconsideration of the Supreme Court decision is not going to happen because they have said we have given a decision, you interpret it in the way you want, but we have given this particular decision as such. Then when it comes to this Provident Fund or ESIC for March 20, a lot of people could not pay this on time because of the lockdown or other reasons. Now, whether the time is extended or not, I don't think this time has been extended by the government to pay my Provident Fund or ESIC. Now, if this is not therefore paid on time, maybe even for lockdown reasons, reporting will come under CARO and there could be implications for your tax provisioning also if this PF ESI has not been paid within time or an extended time which has been allowed in case it is allowed by the PF authorities or something. You have this Code of Wages Act of 2019 which came. And this code repeals 5-6 acts and they are all consolidated into one act, Code of Wages Act, notified by the government on 21st August. Now, the way this act goes, it is notified by the central government, but the state governments have to pass necessary legislation for this. And I believe Gujarat is one such state which has gone ahead and passed some legislations for this. And there are changes on minimum wages, what is the leave which is there, what is the bonus to be given, what are the deductions you can give. And before 2 months, you had the draft rules which are issued on 7 July 2020. Now, if these rules are finally issued, then even your payment of bonus provisions and all will change. Your set-on, set-off of bonus is likely to change. So please ask your company where you are auditors that have you understood what is this Code of Wages Act? What could be the implications on this? Because once this act really gets implemented, and some states may have actually already implemented this act, there could be additional provisioning which may come in. There are a lot of companies who may still not be even aware that this new act has come on Code of Wages or the bonus which is there as such. Then on income tax, you have applying a correct tax rate because there are now multiple tax rates which a company can apply depending on what is the level of your turnover and whether the company has unabsorbed losses or unused tax credits, which is really the MAT credit which we talk about. The base rates can be 30%, which is a normal tax rate. Could be 25% if your turnover is, say, less than 250 crores, or could be 22%, because that's the concessional rate announced in September 2019 by the Finance Ministry. Now, you have to add the applicable surcharge and cess to these base rates which are there, which could be either 30 or 25 or 22, which is there. Now, the deferred tax rate also will automatically accordingly change, because deferred tax rate will fall in line normally with your base tax rate. However, you can have a situation where your current tax rate is 25 and maybe your deferred tax rate would become 22. And I've given a very simple illustration for that. Your current tax rate is 25 and all your losses are getting set off in the current year. Obviously, therefore, from next year, the company is likely to adopt a rate of 22%, because that's a concession allowed by the finance ministry. Now, when I'm having a situation like this, my deferred tax provision, which I do for the next year, will be at 22% and not at 25%. Though the current tax rate is 25%, my deferred tax rate will be 22%, because that is the rate at which my reversal will start happening on the deferred tax liabilities or the deferred tax assets which are there. So something which a lot of people don't really pay attention, because typically your current tax and the deferred tax rates are taken the same, but you can have different rates for current tax and deferred tax, as you can see from this particular illustration which is there. On disputed tax liabilities, you had this Vivad Se Vishwas scheme which came in the finance bill. The last date was has been extended to 31st December. And there are a lot of companies who are contemplating going under this VSV scheme which is there. And if a company is contemplating going under this particular scheme, as auditors, you may need to take a decision whether you need to provide for the basic amount which is there, or you need to modify some figures in your contingent liabilities. And it is good to advise a company to add a disclosure in the notes saying that the company intends to use the benefit of this particular scheme and maybe reverse some extra provisioning or change the figure of contingent liabilities or whatever which is there as such. On the GST related things, during this last year, you had the audit of GST which was conducted for 17-18, where the last date was December 19. Now you need to examine that Form 9C for the audit report of GST for 17-18 and check up whether any additional GST or interest was paid therein. And for that, you have to really check up that Form DRC3, which is there for payment of GST or interest which has arisen because of audit. Also check up whether there are any disclaimers or qualifications in that 9C which can impact your 18-19 or 19-20 financial year. Input tax credit related or ITC related. If you know how this GST ITC works, you normally can take 110% of the matched eligible GST on monthly basis. Because of the lockdown, there was a relaxation given for the period Feb 20 to August 20. And for this period, there was a claim of eligible ITC was allowed as per financial records, irrespective of what was the credit reflected in that 2A form which is there. However, the relaxation said that everything what is there, excess shortfall, has to get adjusted in that GSTR 23B for September 2020. Now, this is something you will have to be carefully observing when you are finalizing accounts for March 20, because whether for all ITC up to March 20, you are really finally going to be eligible or not to claim the ITC, you can easily find out if you look at all these returns which are there as such. Interest on delayed payment of GST up to March 20, the due dates were extended, but interest became payable. So, for March 20, up to March 20, if you have still not paid the GST, fine, that provision is there, but also make a provision for interest, because interest, there was no relaxation given, which is there. If your material sent for job work and it is not returned within time limits, it is treated as a supply as per the GST law. Now, is there any GST liability on this? There is no relaxation given on this under any relaxations given by the government on GST or ITC or the tax payments which are there. So if your company has a situation where material is being sent on job work, not returned within time limits, even within or even because of a lockdown situation? Is there a GST liability, whether it can be treated as a supply with the corresponding liability and so on? When it comes to some other indirect taxes on export obligations, now export obligations typically are EPGC obligations which are there. You may not be able to fulfill the obligation because of the lockdown or the low demand which is now likely to be there for your products and exports which have practically stopped in a lot of cases. Now, these obligations can be extended by paying some penal interest. So what is the stand of the company on this likely to be? Is it going to extend the obligation by penal interest? And you will have to look at this especially for all obligations which are up to March 21. Because for April 20 to March 21, the obligations may not be fulfilled. And if they are not likely to be fulfilled, do I need to make a provision for that liability? Do I need to provide for some penal interest? Whether it can continue as a contingent liability, that's a call which you will need to really take in that sense. Now, in case I am not likely to fulfill my obligations and I pay import duties, on the duties per se, I may get an input tax credit after I make the payment. But the penal interest which I pay, I may not get any ITC on that. So that's an extra provisioning which would become necessary. Now, all this will have also 43B implications. So whether in taxation, how do I treat it as a current tax deductibility or whether I need to adjust it against my deferred tax also. On this MEIS scheme, where you get a benefit based on your exports, you will clearly need to now find out whether the claims are filed within time limits. If there are delays in filing the claims, there would be obviously delays in recovery, and therefore maybe is any provision necessary for any likely delays. If you have seen last 10 days, there is a sunset clause of MEIS now announced by the government. So after December 20, no MEIS claims would be allowed. And there is a limit of claims of only 2 crores from September to December 2020. Now, looking to all this, you may have to take a call as to whether a company which has a lot of old amounts receivable under MEIS, whether any provisioning is necessary, whether it will really receive those amounts. Typically, MEIS is at 5%, provided at 5%. And I can sell this MEIS benefits also, in which I can get maybe about 3% or 4%. There is also a possibility that some of these MEIS claims which are there, I can use it to adjust against my export obligations for EPGC. So whether that is permissible, ask the company whether you are contemplating using some of these MEIS benefits to fulfill your export obligation. That is technically permitted under the customs law. If that is so, you can offset both against each other in that sense. You need to have a discussion with the management on what are they really likely to do. I believe a lot of auditors don't really get into this aspect or the GST aspect, but I believe in this situation where things are becoming difficult even for indirect taxes, you will need to ask the company because this can have a lot of financial implications. On the FEMA and RBI front, you have this loan moratorium which came because of the lockdown. So banks are instructed to give borrowers a grace period of 3 years, which was extended up to August 20. And now we are waiting for the Supreme Court decision to decide what further concessions will be available. However, interest will continue to be charged during the moratorium. Now, if a company has taken a moratorium, it clearly impacts your classification of current and non-current, because what was earlier current can now become non-current because you have taken an extended moratorium or something as such. Then the RBI was also extended in April 20, the time period for realization and repatriation of export proceeds to 15 months. Earlier it was 9 months, now they have extended to 15 months. Now, this affects your provisioning for doubtful debts, your ECL provisioning and so on. Now, based on all these changes under FEMA and the loan moratorium thing, the auditor may actually need to find out whether any impairment testing needs to be done or any extra provisioning needs to be done for my export proceeds or some similar other things which are there. And on the moratorium thing, whether it's current or non-current, whether interest provision is necessary, not necessary, the interest figures can change. because in the moratorium, the interest continues. So all your EMIs and everything may change, even for a car loan or some similar loans which are there as such. That brings you to the next set of changes which are on this accounting standards or Ind AS which are there. Now, these are really the set of standards which are applicable for financial year 1920, depending on what category of your entity is. So if you are following Ind AS, you have 40 standards to follow, which are applicable to listed companies, NBFCs, which is now in that phase four, all companies above a threshold, which is 250 crores, and subsidiaries and associates of the above, which could be even a small company of 5 crores. If you're not following under Ind AS, then you have got 27 standards to follow. And the Institute is very soon telling that all these 27 standards also we are going to upgrade to make it in line with the Ind AS standards. So finally, I believe these first two columns are going to merge and you will finally have only one set of standards, which will obviously become more complicated because they are merging the AS to Ind AS, or they are migrating AS to Ind AS rather than the other way around. And if you are a partnership firm or a LLP, you have got ICAI notified standards, which are 27. Now, as you saw, we had this schedule 3 where the Institute gave out guidance notes on division 1. It was a revised guidance note somewhere in July 19. And the revised guidance note for non-Ind AS companies, the disclosure of companies operating cycle is recommended. So if you are even a private limited company, what is your operating cycle will need to be defined. The word fixed asset is replaced by property, plant, equipment. Contractual payments cannot be included as trade payables. They have to be disclosed as others. Payment to MSMEs disclosure is there. Market value of mutual funds which are not quoted but NAV is available, then you show them non-quoted but still disclose the NAV which is there. Extra disclosure on 186.4, that guidance is given. Revenue has to be always net of GST. That is clearly laid out now. Share or profit from a partnership firm or LLP, how do you disclose, is given there. And for a finance company, you can show this as a separate line item, dividend, rental income, or fees and commission income. Now, this applies even to small private limited companies. So make sure you follow this. These are changes which were given in July 19, revised guidance note on Division 1 of Schedule 3. Similarly, you have got Division 2 on Ind AS. Again, a guidance note came in. And for condensed financial statements, what is the format was given, disclosure for MSMEs. If you see Ind AS Division 2 Schedule 3, on trade receivables, there are two extra items which are given there. Trade receivables with a significant increase in credit risk and which are credit impaired. Now, the guidance is given in, or a good lot of material is given in this guidance note as to how do you interpret this and how do you disclose this, what is with a significant increase in credit risk and what is credit impaired as such. So this is that guidance which is there on the increase in credit risk and credit impaired. Because in both the cases, you may still have a ECL provisioning to be done for expected credit loss. So how do we integrate the provision for expected credit loss in trade receivables, which are either credit impaired or which have a significant increase in credit risk? That is given in this revised version of the guidance note, which is there. On Indian accounting standards or Ind AS, there were so many amendments which came in the month of April itself. So we had amendments in 101, 103, 104, 7, 9, 13, 15. And this new standard was notified, Ind AS 116, which replaced Ind AS 17. So once this standard has come, there is no concept like operating lease. All leases really become finance leases. The corresponding AS 17 has not been changed. That still remains as it is. However, in Ind AS, there is no concept now like operating lease. Every lease becomes a finance lease as such. Similarly, some other changes which came were on this Ind AS 12, income taxes to insert, they inserted an appendix C on uncertainty over tax treatments in 19, 23, 28, 109 and 111 on associate and joint ventures. Now, this income tax amendment is a very far-reaching amendment. where if you are under Ind AS, it says that now you ascertain what is the probability of a disputed tax liability, and based on the probability, make a provision for it in your financial statements. In other words, if you have a tax dispute which is going on and your demand is say about 5 crores, this appendix C says that out of 5 crores, what is the probability that you will win that appeal or something? And based on maybe the lawyer's advice or the counsel advice, you believe that you have a 20% chance to win the appeal, then out of 5 crores, the remaining 80% is something which you may need to provide as a provision in the books of account, not necessarily a contingent liability. Now, that probability approach is still not there in the AS 22, which is there, but be sure that is also likely to be there maybe by March 21 or maybe latest by March 22. Where based on probability of your winning or losing a tax matter, you will start making provisions of the related amounts in the books of accounts rather than only showing it as a contingent liability. On Ind AS for NBFCs and asset reconstruction companies, there were some clarifications which were issued, and this ARCs and NBFCs had to start preparing even in the second phase their financial statements using Ind AS as such. Okay. So now to the auditing aspects, everything so far was really as accountants or the preparers, what did they do, they really need to look into. Of course, as auditors also, we need to be aware as to what are those things. But auditing is clearly what as auditors we need to look at when we are issuing our audit reports. Now, you can see some lighter slides there. So Steve takes evidence gathering very seriously. I don't know as auditors whether we are able to do this, but the public expects us to do this. Take a dog with us and go to each corner of the office to see what is right, what is wrong or something. We obviously believe that this is not our job, but this is what the society believes we should be doing. And though everyone says you do things with a surprise element, this is how we cannot go this far, that you cannot go in and do a surprise audit by landing right from the air or something. You have to inform the company in advance that you are there to do an audit as such. Right, so on auditing, what are the changes which happened? You had the standards of auditing where on SA 720, auditor's responsibility on other information, which is like director's report, your management discussions and analysis. There was an implementation guide given on SA 720. Implementation guide given for going concern SA 570. This is an important guidance note because in the COVID situation, in a lot of cases, this going concern can get triggered. There were MCQs issued on engagement and quality control standards for all the 46 standards on auditing which were there, which was issued in June 20. Now, this is a very recent publication, June 20. In the lockdown, this was issued, but have a look at it because it covers all the 46 standards on auditing. And as we saw earlier, the institute has issued a guidance note and MCQs for CARU 2020. You need not open this book also. You need not even look at the cover of this book. This is relevant for next year. Now on financial statements, when you are doing an audit, you will have to be careful on these items in your financial statements. So on inventory, if you have not been able to take a physical inventory, what are the steps or precautions you need to take? Many companies are giving the emphasis of matter on property, plant, equipment. In this, how do I take care of my CWIP? How do I do depreciation? Is there any work in progress which could have got damaged or something? That is something I need to understand from the company. Going back to inventory, when I am valuing inventory on cost or NRV, whichever is lower, there could be very typical issues which will arise. Take for instance, a company is in the food sector or the healthcare sector. As of 31st March, the inventory of food which is there is having a validity of maybe 2 months or 3 months. However, till June, nothing moved because for 3 months there was a lockdown. So the inventory which got obsolete on 30th June might as well have got obsolete on 31st March because subsequently nothing was done for the next 3 months. So you'll have to think about such situations when we are looking as auditors on things like inventory, and the industry is something like the food industry or maybe industry where you are into perishable goods or something. On borrowing costs, whether this lockdown or whether this situation gives rise to a situation of suspension of borrowing costs, and both AS 16 and Ind AS 23 talks about this suspension of borrowing costs. You will need to look at how these borrowing costs need to be accounted for, whether it's a cost to be added in the P&L to the asset or it is to be taken as a suspension. Impairment of non-financial assets, which is really impairment of property, plant, equipment. I normally look at a DCF calculation for my property, plant, equipment. A DCF calculation in a lockdown situation becomes very difficult. So when I look at a lockdown situation and a DCF calculation, I should normally treat the lockdown situation as an exceptional thing. So I cannot extrapolate that situation to the future years. So my entire DCF calculation can undergo a change when I am testing for impairment of a non-financial asset as such. On financial instruments, I have to pay extra care on MTM provisioning, mark-to-market provisioning, ECL provisioning, impairment of investments, and so on. On leases, whether my lease concessions are coming in, because a lot of concessions on lease have come in because of the lockdown. Though a lot of them would be really after March, a lot of my disclosures can change because I have to give disclosures about whether it's a cancelable lease, non-cancelable lease and all. So even things have happened after the lockdown, it can still have an impact on my financial statements. Revenue recognition, my cutoff date could be a very difficult thing. A lot of people say that it was better if the lockdown had started on 1st April, then everything would have been very easy to account and audit. Unfortunately, the lockdown started somewhere on 18 March, which is where those last 15 days or last 12 days cutoff procedures and all need to be very clearly looked at. My material was ready to be shipped. I could not ship it. Obviously, the revenue recognition cannot happen. On income taxes, a lot of people who had paid advance tax by taking a concessional rate of 22% now say that we want to go back to 25% because I may not now be able to have so much profits that I can absorb 22% in the future years. So let me go back to my 25% and use my MAT credit or my unabsorbed losses in a better way. So look at that, because things can change even from a tax angle in that sense. Retirement benefit provisions. All my calculations have changed for actuarial valuations. My attrition rate could have changed. My increment rate would change because my increments will really stop for 1 year or 2 years. So look at the new tables which are given by the actuary and see whether they are in line with the reality which is there as such. Provisions, contingent liabilities and assets. Again, we saw that on all the above things, there could be some extra provisioning necessary. There could be liabilities if some force majeure clause has been invoked and so on. Subsequent events. My subsequent event, normally we don't look at it too much in a regular year, but in this year in a lockdown situation, this is something which you need to look at very closely, because a lot of subsequent events right up to maybe even August 20 or September 20 will give impact to my balance sheet of March 20. In the past, that has never happened that it has extended so much because things were working in a normal situation. But this year, because of the lockdown and the consequent business disruption, lot of subsequent events which have happened even in the next 6 months can have an impact on your balance sheet for March 20. Government grants. The government has given some grants to some industries because of this lockdown which is there. Now, whether the company is fulfilling those conditions for giving a grant, can it be said that the grant can be accounted for in March itself because the lockdown situation started in March? These are things which you will need to ask the client and get into. Exceptional items. If a loss is because only of a lockdown or this COVID-19 situation, can I show it as an exceptional item? I have a huge inventory loss in March mainly because of a lockdown. Can I show it as an exceptional item? Some big companies like Reliance have shown a write-down of inventory on their fuel stock, on their crude oil and fuel stock as an exceptional item. Now, can you extend this and say that even if my inventory of, say, perishable goods, if I'm providing that on an NRV basis, is it an exceptional item? This is something, again, you will need to discuss and decide the correct disclosure. And finally, on going concern. does the lockdown and all the earlier other things impact my going concern? Going concern reporting this year, I think, is the most crucial, because a lot of companies going forward may not have a future. So whether going concern is fulfilled, not fulfilled, and so on. And let me tell you, though in accounting or maybe in filings, in compliances, there have been relaxations. When it comes to doing an audit or giving an audit report, there is zero relaxation. There is no relaxation at all when you are issuing an audit report. So there is no guidance which will say that this time be liberal in your audit reports and don't issue a qualified or a modified opinion as such. In fact, the guidance is the reverse, that please issue modified reports because the companies are having an uncertain future which is there. So if a client comes and says, this was a lockdown situation, please be lenient with me, I think you have to do the reverse. You have to be more strict this time rather than being lenient on a client, because there are no relaxations on reporting or conducting audit in that sense. In fact, when a peer review happens next year, they are going to look very closely and see whether you have been more strict in your audit in this particular year as such. On the documentation related, your documentation will change because you need a modified audit plan due to the work from home situation. Your testing and reporting process on ICFR due to a modified financial closure policy. Your sampling procedures will need to change because you are now not able to do the sampling as was normally possible. And because you are doing that work from home basis, a lot of judgment calls you have taken. Now, all those judgment calls will need to be documented. If you look at SQC1, which is the main standard on documentation or quality, that standard says that within 60 days of audit report, your file should be completed. Now, due to this lockdown, obviously you cannot or may not be able to fulfill the 60-day period. Now, you will need some internal documentation, maybe the minutes of a meeting with the audit partners, that my documentation of 60 days cannot be completed because of the lockdown. I want to extend this maybe to 31st December or 30th September or whatever. Normally, it is to be done within 60 days once you sign the audit report, which is there as such. So in auditing, this slide is very important from your documentation perspective. And the earlier slide is very important from a perspective as to how do you look at all these items, mainly because of a COVID-19 situation which is there. On this, maybe 10 or 12 points, there is a detailed article, frankly, which I have written, which I think it is published by AIFTB somewhere in June or something. Maybe BCA can get hold of that article and host it or give a link to that particular site or something. Lastly, we come to this NFRA AQRRs is audit quality review reports and some orders. Now, NFRA, as we saw, acquired power on 15th August 2019. As I said, the whole country was celebrating that we got independence. Auditors should not have been so happy on that day, because NFRA started doing its work on that particular day. Now, this is what really NFRA looks like. So in this thing, instead of that word police, you replace NFRA. So NFRA says to the auditor, did you not see the red light? The auditor says, yes, I saw the red light. NFRA is asking you, then why did not you stop? The auditor is saying, I did not see you, which means the auditor is aware as to there is a red light. I cannot go beyond the level. But then they said, since we don't know NFRA, let us go ahead and break that red light, which is there as such. That is exactly what has happened when a lot of auditors or a lot of firms have got caught into this NFRA perspective, which is there as such. And this is the action which NFRA has already taken against audit firms. And this is on public domain. There is nothing confidential about this. This is all taken from the orders which are hosted on the NFRA website. So they have carried out audit quality review for one company, which is IFIN, which is ILFS Financial Services Limited, for financial year 17-18. There were two auditors for the same. The AQR commenced in Feb, got ended in September, and the final report was issued in November, a big report, 163 pages. Last month, you had a report of the other firm, which was issued, again, 256 pages. Based on the AQR report of the first firm, they banned three partners. for 7 years, 5 years each, and a penalty of different amounts, which is as per the powers given to NFRA. The orders are kept in abeyance because there are Delhi High Court hearings likely to happen in September 20 against it. For the other firm also, we can soon expect some orders to be passed. We do not know whether they issue suspension or penalty or what, but we can expect that against some other, the other firm also. And you can expect some very high cost litigation and also maybe some reputation loss with which can be there amongst this firm. But this is all in public domain. There's nothing really confidential about this today. Now, what are the observations? We are not concerned about what action they took or something. We are more concerned now about what were the observations of NFRA, which we have to take care of or something. And the, these are the 5 observations of NFRA, which we are all really going to be concerned about and spend maybe sometimes sleepless nights also. The NFRA said that if you are providing non-audit work or non-attest services to audit clients, you are not eligible to be appointed the auditor because there is a conflict of interest. Now, this is far reaching because they have interpreted the term what is called management services, which we will see in the next slide also. They are saying there is a lot of independence and self-review or a self-interest threat which is there. And by looking at the audit files of these two firms, they said standards on auditing were not applied because they are literally looking at the standards of auditing para by para and seeing whether you have followed the standards. They have looked at the firm's IT systems and they are saying that the IT systems cannot be relied upon. Now they are talking about two firms which are highly respectable firms in that sense, and they are questioning the those firms' IT systems and documentation. And they are defining or rather interpreting what is subsequent events as per SA 560. They are extending the date of subsequent events right up to the date when the notices are posted to shareholders, not necessarily the date when you signed off the financial statements. So these are 5 things which has a very far-reaching implication on the auditing profession as such. And that is why if you see my very first slide of the presentation, I said that the whole audit profession has been shaken up because of these 5-6 observations of NFRA. And BCA obviously at its level is trying to gather some consensus and represent to NFRA or the government or maybe to the institute to come out with the right approach in such things which are there as such. Now on the illegal appointment, it said that the firm had violated these 2 sections of the Companies Act, which are appointment sections. If you look at that second section, 141(3)(i), it talks about section 144, which includes management services. And that is why, that is where NFRA has hit the maximum. Now, NFRA has said that 144 talks about management services. And if you read what is given in red there, management services has to be taken as services performed by the statutory auditor or any network partner for the management, either in the form of doing action functions which would otherwise have to be done or undertaken by the management. That is okay. The second is very far reaching, providing any kind of support inclusive of analysis, research, advice that is required by the management for performance of those functions or actions. Now, this can cover everything. It can cover your appearing to the tax authorities. It can cover your tax advice, what is given, which they are saying that if you are an auditor and if you are doing all this, it is supposed that you are, it is assumed that you are also rendering management services. The Code of Ethics does not define management services. The ministry does not define management services. Institute doesn't define management services. So everyone said that this cannot be covered, but NFRA said that in our view, all such services are covered as management services. And therefore, if you are an auditor, you cannot provide these services. If you are doing so, your appointment is illegal and you are covered under this NFRA penal provisions, which are there as such. Now, the problem is compounded because if you look at the Income Tax Act and you are looking at the section of tax audit, in tax audit, it takes you to section 288(2), which defines what is an accountant. And it says it means a chartered accountant who holds a valid certificate, but does not include. In the case of a company, a person who is not eligible in accordance with section 141(3). And we have seen earlier 141(3) takes you back to 144. 144 takes you to this NFRA definition. And what that therefore means is, in a company, if you are doing a tax audit, and if you are also rendering other services, you can get caught in the definition what NFRA is trying to interpret for management services. And your appointment as a tax auditor could be illegal in that sense. Fortunately, under the GST Act, such a definition is not there, probably because GST audits can also be conducted by cost accountants. Now, this is where we are really grappling in the dark as to what is likely to happen in the future. Now, there are implications on this. The implications are, if you are doing a statutory audit or a tax audit or a GST audit or maybe even a transfer pricing certification, can I provide these services like valuation, compliance, advisory, unrelated representation, or even a transfer pricing study? So, can I provide non-audit services to clients where I am doing, say, statutory audit, tax audit, or GST audit, whether covered by NFRA or not covered by NFRA? Obviously, I don't have any answers for this. I would like to be as hopeful as all of you to see to it that we can render both the services, because otherwise the whole profession is going to be badly hit about this. And therefore, urgent need for ICAI or MCA to come up with some clarifications, because tomorrow income tax department can come and say NFRA has interpreted this. It's a government department. I am also going to use the definition if you are doing a tax audit and also doing tax representation. So where will it finally lead us to? It is all going to create a lot of chaos in the profession as to what can be done, what really cannot be done as such. All right, so this is, I believe, how the NFRA approaches audits. Having audited your accounts, we can't find anything suspicious, which however makes us very suspicious. So this is how really how NFRA is approaching their reviews or orders which are there as such. And if this is likely to be done by a lot of other regulators, like maybe your SFIO or MCA, your CAG, then you are really in for bad time if you are auditors of a company as such. Okay, the last thing I just want to remind everyone is about this UDIN. UDIN is something which is now part of our life, and you have a lot of things where you really need to take a UDIN on all these activities which are there. Whether any certificate, reports, whatever you issue, you need a UDIN which is there. And with all these responsibilities of auditors, all these things you are taking care of, this is what I thought I can put it as a current scenario for auditors. We are at 7:30. This is my last slide. So this is what I believe is our current scenario for auditors. But I think we can overcome all this as we have done in the past also. And therefore, I end on a happy note that I wish you all a happy auditing and maybe sweet dreams. I don't know whether you will be able to sleep properly now, but at least you can have some sweet dreams on issuing good audit reports. So thank you, everyone. And back to maybe Abhay or Suhas.
Thank you, Himanshu Bhai. Will you like to take one or two important questions if you feel?
Yeah, not a problem at all.
So,
can I read it from the Q&A box or will you tell me which one I need to answer?
Abhay or Amit, can you
just... I think, Himanshu, you can consider whichever is more relevant, only you can take up, not an issue.
Okay, shall I put off? Shall I close the presentation?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So I hope I covered a lot of things which was expected.
Yes.
So this is one question on 135, which is on CSR. As per 135, is CSR requirement to be fulfilled for previous year outstanding as well? The answer is yes, because earlier year CSR, if you have not fulfilled, becomes part of current year CSR. So far, no penal consequences, but once penal consequences start, then you will have to transfer it to the government designated fund, which is there. So on the which fund to be transferred, I don't have answers because that section is to be notified. As per notification, AGM period is extended. Is it necessary to complete and sign audit report before 30th September before time limit to close audit is within 6 months from close of the year? I think auditors have no time limit. Auditors have to sign when the accounts are ready and you are in a position to sign. There is nothing like a time limit for auditors. Time limits apply really only to the companies. So, and I don't see anywhere where there is a time limit to complete an audit within 6 months. Whether NFRA compliance requirements are applicable to auditor of foreign subsidiary of listed company. This applies obviously to only Indian audit firms, not audit firms which are outside India, because they are covered by their own country's regulations. Whether any note is required to be given in audit report regarding carrying out audit online with soft copy and no physical verification. A note is not required, but your internal documentation would need to be robust on it. But if you believe that you are having some scope limitation, that you are not able to see proper samples and all, then obviously you may need to give an emphasis of matter. But there is no note which is required in that sense. So I think all others are very routine things. What is last date of filing NFRA form and other things? I think this is all I would need to answer.
Thank you, Himanshu Bhai, for an excellent presentation. And I think you can see in the chat box that everybody is saying that this is a ready referencer for the audit 2020. So that was the purpose. And I think you have served the purpose extremely well. With these brief remarks, I will tell Amit to make some announcements and vote of thanks to Himanshu Bhai.
Sure. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay. Friends, before I propose a hearty vote of thanks to the speaker, would like to inform the viewers about certain interesting programs which are lined up. First, we have a program on brand building by professional firms by brand guru Jagdeep Kapoor on this Saturday, 12th September at 10:30, which will be followed by question and answer session. Then we have got another interesting panel discussion coming up on alternative approach to taxation of digital economy on 19th of September, which will be at 2 p.m. which is again a very interesting program. Then we have got a long duration study course on MLI and related action plans beginning on 25th of September. We have a very interesting program on M&A masterclass, which will be having 6 sessions, which is beginning tomorrow, 10th of September, and which will deal with different aspects of M&A. So again, this is a very interesting and good program. So, we have been sending the mailers in this regard, and I urge the viewers to register for these programs. Now, coming to the pleasant task of vote of thanks. Friends, you all agree that we had an excellent and captivating session by our speaker. Our speaker covered the subject along with the relevant amendments with such an ease and simplicity and within the time allotted. He captured all the important aspects relating to accounting, auditing, Companies Act, which are to be kept in mind while doing or conducting the audit for financial year 19-20. I am sure after listening to him, we'll be better equipped knowledge-wise to deal with the subject. Thank you, Himanshu Bhai, for having accepted our invitation and sparing your valuable time during this busy audit season and enlightening us on the subject, and which also shows your love for the BCAS in particular and the profession in general for spreading knowledge and awareness. And I am sure we will have the benefit of listening to you again and again in the upcoming years. With this, on behalf of the BCAS and all the viewers present in the meeting, I propose a hearty vote of thanks and request all of you to carry it out with loud applause.
Thank you, Amit. Thank you, everyone. My pleasure.
Thank you.